since this very show, Innovative Mind with Audrey Tang, you're free to remix it, to make songs about it, to make music videos, or really do whatever. And this freedom of doing whatever enables a co-creation, meaning that we also enjoy your creativity instead of you just being the reseller, redistributor of what we have produced. You too can become a co-producer. Local time, everyone, and welcome to this new episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. Today, I'm here with open source promoter, international open government advocate, and a fellow digital transformation geek, Pia Andrews. Pia has crossed the boundaries between tech and politics for over two decades, from becoming president of Linux Australia at 23 and later on founding an award-winning open source consultancy at 26. Pia went on to work as a consultant and director for many government initiatives across Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. 20 months after being listed as one of the most influential people in digital government by Apolitical, in 2020, Pia wrote 20 articles in 20 days to reflect on her 20 years of experience in promoting innovation in government. Now, 20 months on, we meet with her to try to understand how she sees the world with such 2020 clarity. After being listed as one of the most influential people in digital government by Apolitical, in 2020, Pia wrote 20 articles in 20 days to reflect on her 20 years of experience in promoting innovation in government. 20 months on, we meet with her to try to understand how she sees the world with such 2020 clarity. Hi, Pia.
Thank you so much. Hi, thank you so much for having me. I'm definitely a numbers geek, and 2020.
Yeah, it's been years, 5 years, if I remember correctly, since we met in Kuifu. And I learned there that you have been practicing the martial arts, or as we say here, Kung Fu. Is it true? Do you still practice nowadays?
I do. I train Shaolin Kung Fu, as you know, as it's properly pronounced. And the wonderful thing about Kung Fu is it teaches one not just how to do martial arts, but how to do something so well that we transcend the act itself.
Okay, so a Kung Fu geek. That's excellent.
Absolutely.
And I have to ask you, so you're very proficient in a lot of different seemingly unrelated areas. So what are you bad at?
Oh, everyone has areas to learn. I'm sure my family would happily tell you many, but I'm terrible at cooking. I'm terrible at keeping time for something once I get very enthusiastic about it. And, you know, there's always more to learn about everything in the world.
Trust me, I know that feeling. So I want to take you back to your childhood and early life. Like me, you're a self-taught coder. And how did you get interested in coding in the first place?
My mum was the technologist in my family. So she was learning computers in the early 80s and was actually setting up networks and business systems for the small town that I grew up in. So I grew up around technology at a time where a lot of my peers didn't. And, you know, and as I think a lot of people do when we're young, I got into computers through gaming more so than anything else in the first instance. And later on, I was trying different ways and different potential careers. And after trying a few different things, including, by the way, studying Chinese medicine, I actually went to IT as my backup plan while I figured out what I wanted to do. I actually started as a sysadmin more than a direct programmer, so more scripting than programming, but still plenty of tech. And I just realized after a very short time working in the sector, I discovered open source. And I discovered this wonderful place where my technical skills that I'd had my whole life and my personal values suddenly intersected, and I could see that technology could be a values-laden and way to actually make the world a better place. And that hooked me, and I've been a passionate technologist ever since, and felt a very deep responsibility as a maker to contribute my skills to making the world a better place, because there's so many people that just use their tech skills to just build whatever they're told. But when we do values-based and values-driven technology, we can truly make the world better.
I remember Laurel saying that the program is what you give the audience and the script is what you give the actors. So the people who with agency can script a existing system to do differently. But to do so and without getting lawsuits, the ideas of open source is at the very center of it. So for a non-technical audience, how do you usually explain the ideas of open source?
Open source is a few things. First of all, to be a little bit boring, it's just a way of developing software. That's what a lot of people think of it. It's a way of working openly. It's a way of working collaboratively, having open access to the instructions that sit under, you know, a program or a piece of software means that we can collaborate on mutual needs, on creating something that we all can build upon and work upon. So on one hand, it's just an easier way of making better quality software. But of course, it's so much more. It feeds into a philosophical basis of being able to have the freedom to have access to software, have access to the instructions that sit behind the decisions that affect you, being able to take and contribute back into that and actually be part of shaping your own destiny, not just having destiny thrust upon you. And it's also a massive and global community of people driven by some pretty fundamental values, which then means that anywhere you go in the world, you can connect with open source communities, for instance, open source software communities that collectively want to actually use their skills for better. So it's actually quite inspiring when people hear about that. A lot of people think technology is just this sort of this tool that they use, and starting to realize, I think, and people are starting to realize that if you don't actually embed values into technology, if you don't embed human values into technology, then you don't get human outcomes from what is built. I don't know, you can probably be even more concise. How would you describe it?
Well, I would say since this very show, Innovative Minds with Audrey Tong, is in the Creative Commons with attribution license, it means that as long as you don't spell wrong the names of Pia Andrews and Audrey Tong, you're free to remix it, to make songs about it, to make music videos, or really do whatever. And this freedom of doing whatever enables a co-creation, meaning that we also enjoy your creativity instead of you just being the reseller, redistributor of what we have produced. You too can become a co-producer.
I think that there's something quite powerful and intuitive for everybody that hears it when you start talking about co-creation, because as a species, you know, we have spent 200,000 years co-creating our own evolution, and it's only when you have open access to be able to build on the back of each other's innovation, of each other's ideas, that we can progress as a society. Actually locking up our intelligence, locking up our intellect as property is actually counterintuitive to the other 199,900 years of our evolution.
So in your 20s, you became president of Linux Australia. So I think at the age of 23. How did you become a leader of such a large advocacy group at such a young age?
That's a fairly funny story, actually. So I discovered open source and discovered and was going along to our local Linux user group, Sydney Linux user group, and a slug, of course. And I was absolutely enraptured with the opportunity and the possibilities of this space. So I started saying, well, isn't there a national group? Like, shouldn't we be advocating around open source? Shouldn't we be trying to help government to understand it? Shouldn't we be trying to, you know, participate in these kind of public conversations? And people said, well, there is actually a national national entity, but it's not doing a whole lot right now. And it's really got a bit of just a legacy of flame war mailing lists, and it's not really active. So I actually sought out the board that was there at the moment, the committee that was there at the time, and sat down with them and sort of talked about, look, there's this fantastic opportunity. The annual conference, Linux Conf AU, which is an amazing open source conference in Australia that attracts people from all around the world, is coming up. Why don't you just open up membership so that anyone that goes to LCA can become members? And actually, that gives you an annual pulse to actually be able to grow community, to engage with community, to represent community, and to identify what's needed. And they agreed to do that. And I sort of thought that was great. And I literally spent half of the conference going around and talking to people about, look, you know, what do you think would be the benefit, if any, of a national organization? And people sort of went, oh, well, you know, but there is one, but it doesn't do anything. I'm like, yeah, yeah, just put that to the side. What could it do? Mm-hmm. And so I turned a lot of people around. We had, I think, I don't remember now, 200 or so or 150 people turn up to the AGM, which was unheard of in many years. And someone actually nominated me for president ahead of the thing. And I was quite shocked. One of the speakers that I had heard was, which I still have a huge amount of thanks to this wonderful man, Bidal Garbi, who was the leader of the Debian community at the time, or Debian project at the time. So I sought him out and said, look, I've been nominated for this thing. I have no idea what I'm doing. What do you think? And he's like, just go for it. So he encouraged me. I sought out a few other people. It was very encouraging, and I really went for the nomination, and I got almost everyone vote for me for president, which is very exciting. And I really went about it in a way to say, not that Linux Australia should be a top-down entity, but more that it should be an umbrella entity that should actually support Linux user groups, support community initiatives, and support people to be successful. And then as part of that, engage with government and the rest. So it was a real journey, and I learned a lot, and huge thanks to Bidal, to Tridge and Rusty and Hugh and all the other wonderful people that supported and participated in that. And we really turned it around. Linux Australia, of course, has gone on to be just a wonderful organisation and so supportive of so many initiatives. And I feel very proud that I had a small part to play in that, but also just so proud of the community in Australia, how it's grown and evolved over the years.
It's not in all areas that people in their early 20s can crowdsource essentially the platform and become a leader on a national level. But what I have witnessed is that in open source or open government and other open access and so in communities, it's people with this listening skill that get people to actually speak their visions and missions, and they become kind of servant leaders, like not manager at all, but just skilled facilitators that then become this leadership in name, but actually everyone become a co-creator to them. And I think you embody that value in your work. So what advice would you give to someone in their early 20s, maybe 23 this year, who are interested in doing similar things in open source, open government, or any of the open areas?
I think the advice that I would give, and it goes to your point about servant leadership, is leadership isn't deciding something and then charging ahead and telling people to follow you. Really, the best way to scale your impact or anyone's impact is to empower people around you and to support people, to lift them up into the light rather than, you know, trying to minimize the dark. You know, we're going to lift everyone up into the light. So I guess a few of the suggestions I would make would be, first of all, know yourself. Mm-hmm. You need to be very clear on your own values, what you care about, what you are trying to achieve in this world. Because I think a lot of people try to follow in someone else's footsteps, but actually just make your own footsteps. You know, learn from other people, but realize that your journey is your journey alone. And the way, your way, is only going to be found by you. And when you sort of recognize that your meaning and purpose in life is defined by you, that is both, I think, terrifying but also very liberating for people if they can face and adopt that particular level of uncertainty. I think the second one is don't just know your values, know what you're good at. To my earlier point, I'm a terrible cook. There's no point if the thing I want to do is try to make the world a better place, me opening a soup kitchen or trying to feed people, it wouldn't help. So knowing what you're good at and being able to deploy your skills. And as part of that, know yourself, also know your limitations, your natural biases that you need to overcome, and create a what I call a integrity network around yourself. You know, figure out the checks and balances to make sure that you don't unintentionally run off in the wrong direction, mm-hmm. or indeed become a tool for someone else's mm-hmm. wrong direction. So there's a few things there. And the final thing is connect with people, you know, connect with communities, create communities, and be part of something, because together we can do so much. But when we try to do it alone, it is very, very hard. That's partly how I met you, and, you know, being so inspired by the work that you do,
yes.
and connecting together, we can mm-hmm. do so much.
All right. So from this self-knowledge comes autonomy, and then comes integrity, and then comes connection. That's a beautiful progression. So after a short break, we will be back and talk about the other thing we have in common, which is politics. And now we're back to talk about politics. Pia, you've studied political science in university. And what made you so interested in the intersection of tech, which we just talked about, and politics?
I was working, when I was working in the IT sector for the first sort of 9 years after school, in my voluntary life, of course, with Linux Australia, we did a lot of and an increasing amount of advocacy to government. We would talk about, you know, open source. We got into advocacy around free trade agreements, around copyright and software patents, these kinds of things. And I got more and more frustrated with that experience. I did end up meeting a few characters in the political landscape, obviously, through that process, and ended up being hired into a political office as a senior advisor. Now, I don't care for politics per se, but I love democracy, and I love what, you know, a participatory democracy could look like. So it gave me a chance while working in that office to learn about the system, as it were. And it was while working in that office that I really started to understand the role of government mm-hmm. in people's lives, around how policies are made, how changes are made, how laws are made, how democracy does and doesn't function. And it became, I guess, my obsession at that point to help contribute to reforming and transforming the public sector to be fit for purpose in the 21st century. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of public service departments. You know, they were created in the industrial age. They were created 100 years ago in some cases, or hundreds of years ago in some jurisdictions. And they simply were not built for a fast-paced, globalized, rapidly changing, you know, high user experience, internet-laden world. So so I got very much obsessed with that intersection between technology and society and government, at the point where I could see that governments were not transforming themselves. They were creating automation and digitization, but they weren't shifting to a real-time paradigm, to a they weren't shifting from being a king in a castle, which I think is the very common mm-hmm. way of operating. Mm-hmm. They needed to shift to being a node in a network. And that huge shift of realizing that you're part of a system rather than just trying to control a system is a massive cultural shift. So that became my passion. And I when I went to work in the public sector then, about 10 years ago now, I very much focused on Gov 2.0, on open data, on open government systems, on creating the kind of service experience that people expect. And in more recent years, I've become obsessed with creating trustworthy systems mm-hmm. that
a shared obsession.
Yeah, indeed, a shared obsession. So it sort of has evolved over time, but it really has come from, at the very beginning, I think, a passion for a better future, where more people can live well, in fact, where everyone can live well.
In Taiwan, we're setting up in just a few months now the new Ministry of Digital Affairs, or MoDA. And as part of our recruitment, we've been interviewing people who are considering to move from now very well-paid jobs in either the software unicorn companies that Taiwan has quite a few nowadays, or the Odie Bagudi, Taiwan Semiconductor Company, and so on. And all these, of course, are paying well, and salary-wise, we're able to offer something that's equal. But then many of the participants ask, but I am able in the TSMC or in one of the startups to make immediate impact to lots of people. in TSMC, maybe in a quarter, in a startup, maybe in a month or so. Are there similar impacts to be made in the government? Now, I don't know whether you get asked those questions, but hypothetically, how would you answer?
I do actually get asked those questions. And the answer is, it can take longer, although there are definitely things that you can do fast in government for sure. But whether you're doing something fast or slow, the span and scale and scope of impact is so large. You can create something that will help everyone in a country, that will help everyone in a jurisdiction, that could actually help people globally even. So the span of impact, I think, is very important. And I think that when people are very focused on, I just want to deliver something now, there's a very interesting question of to what ends. Now, in private sector, you can build a great product that might be able to help people with an aspect of their life. You might be able to build profit for the company that you work for, et cetera. You might be able to help influence some meaningful, high-impact change. And I think a lot of people in the private sector do, you know, focus on that. But in the public sector, whether you're working in or with the public sector, you have an opportunity to actually help shape people's lives, to help improve equity, to actually make the world a little bit more fair and a little bit more just. And that, I think, is very appealing to people, and something that people, even if you don't choose to go and be a lifelong public servant, you know, I think there's a wonderful opportunity for anyone, you know, go and spend 5 years in the public service, make a real difference on the areas that you care about, and bring your skills and bring your passion and your expertise to making that kind of difference. Even if you go back into the private sector again or to the nonprofit sector again, the opportunity to impact people is so profound.
I'm in. Where do I sign? So I think it's a great pitch. Thank you. Do you have any recent examples of the kind of the impact that you were just talking about equity?
Sure. There are so many examples all the time, but I'll give you one that really speaks to my heart. I have a friend who works in the public sector in one of the countries I've lived, who she meets, you know, with a lot of people in her local community. And she was meeting this older Indigenous lady in this particular community who was telling her how she had applied for a liver transplant and had been told no, computer says no. And this older lady was quite religious and had really sort of resigned herself to, oh, well, you know, I guess my time has come. You know, I've had a good life, so that's okay. And my friend was horrified. She said, well, but what was the reason they said no? And she said, oh, I'm not sure. And she said, well, have you thought about appealing it? Now, the woman's response is very important. The woman said, but government don't make mistakes. Huh. And my friend who works in government said, well, yeah, no, as they say in my region, yeah, nah. So so she encouraged and supported this woman to write an appeal. And the appeal went through and it got reviewed manually outside of the system and came back with a different decision. Now, this woman has since had a successful liver transplant and is still alive as a result. The fact is that the mechanization of our public service systems, policies, processes has led to that lack of explainability, lack of transparency, lack of accountability, and frankly, made it harder to appeal a decision because it's a system that told you no, not a person. And so there's opportunities, I think, to create systems which actually just follow the user story of how would a person know, understand, and appeal this decision. Should be part of every public services user storyboard, right? Mm-hmm. How can we audit and monitor the human impact of this policy, of this service, of this decision in real time and over the long term so that we can understand if there's any unintended harm? Because how can you avoid harm if you're not measuring for harm? So I think there's real opportunities that we can do today. We can change some of the ways that we design and deliver public services today to include some of these basic principles of accountability, transparency, appealability, et cetera. And I think the other thing we can do, which gets a little bit fun, is to, when we're doing service and policy design, to presume and assume machines as users, mm-hmm. not just people as users, but assume that a machine will be an active user of mm-hmm. the service and of the policy and of the law and of the regulation. Because when you assume a machine as a user, you start to build services that won't unintentionally support machines to do bad things. Mm-hmm. You can support the, hey Alexa, I've lost my job, help me find a service, help me find help. But you can also identify and disrupt Phoenix AIs or self-replicating machines that are gaming YouTube to try to drive children, into particular materials or whatever. So, planning for machines as users and building more humane, accountable services are very practical things that we can start to do today.
So just to check my understanding, you're saying that some users, that is to say people using the system, may actually use their own assistive tools, that is to say bots, or they may entirely automate whatever they're going to do interacting with the system. And instead of blocking all the bots with CAPTCHAs and other spam bot fighting technology, maybe we should plan for it. Is that what you're saying?
That is what I'm saying, because I think the future of public services, the future of service delivery full stop, is not in another app or another website. The future is, and the future is here now, is very much around alternative channels. People who are vision impaired already use mm-hmm. voice to interact with
screen
services.
Screen readers.
So why don't we have voice-based services mm-hmm. from the start rather than just having better screen readers? If people want to use their Siris and Alexas and OK Googles, why wouldn't we plan for that and actually figure out, how can I know if this proxy user is authentic mm-hmm. or not, is a mm-hmm. far more interesting question than just blocking them outright.
Mm-hmm. Right. So what you're saying is that this proxy user, which in layperson's terms is like a interpreter, right, that understand a foreign language and translate to a different language, because Taiwan has 20 national languages, and including sign language, by the way. And so instead of building systems and then later on hire sign language translators and so on, maybe we need to understand there's all sort of different interpreters around, and some of them currently human and some of them currently already bots, but to design for this future where every person can interact with their preferred assistant of choice is what service delivery is now going to look like, because without this, we can't anticipate all the needs of our people, of our citizens, and there's no room to co-create better assistive ideas. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, I think that too long we've taken an approach to inclusive design, which has actually resulted in one door mm-hmm. that is the lowest common mm-hmm. denominator. Mm-hmm. And the problem is, why don't we plan for many doors into the mm-hmm. same house? Mm-hmm. The same capabilities, the same functions, the same service, but mm-hmm. choose your door. Mm-hmm. You might choose to come in from the roof.
mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Actually, understanding that a lot of people try to build, a good digital web service that everyone can use.
Yeah, it's called universal design because it applies universally.
exactly. But if you actually wanted to create the most personalized service possible, then being open to other interfaces that a person controls themselves, that interfaces with your system, not with your user interface, starts mm-hmm. to become quite profound, I think. Mm-hmm. There's opportunities there to explore.
Okay, so we'll let my system to talk to your system. Okay. Are there other things toward this vision of building trustworthy systems that you think are important in addition to the principles that you have just outlined?
For sure. If we go back to the legal basis of government, mm-hmm. of departments, services that they administer, indeed of democracy, democratic administration, it all really comes back to the legal authorities under which they operate.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that after a lot of work over the years, a conclusion I came to about 5, maybe 6 years ago was, if we don't provide the rules of eligibility, entitlement, taxation, those prescriptive rules of government as an API, then everyone is being left to interpret those rules and hard code them into myriad business systems. In relation to government systems, that means that the legislation and the operational policy are being mashed up mm-hmm. and then just being implemented. And who knows if a operational policy has actually undermined or overwritten a piece of law. And I can give you several examples that I have found with teams all around the world where the actual law said X, but what was implemented in the code was Y. Mm-hmm. And there's been no check and balance for that because that's not really how it works.
Mm-hmm. That was so the court for a software, yeah.
Rather. So actually having digital law or digital legislation and regulation, at mm-hmm. least for prescriptive rules, available as a utility, as a platform, would not just help government departments to produce more integrated, fair, equitable, trustworthy, traceable and appealable services, but it would help people to be able to test and check the output of their experience with government back against the law, which would be a huge benefit for access to justice and for accountability and auditability of the outcomes of government. It would also be, of course, in the regulatory sphere, very helpful because if you have the prescriptive rules of regulation available as a utility and everyone can just consume them or interact with them in real time, not only do you get a more consistent application of those rules across the economy, but you also get a huge amount of savings, dramatic speed of uptake and implementation, and the ability to actually monitor for the use of those rules, which you just do not have today because everyone's implementing the rules in their own business systems behind locked doors. So digital legislation and regulation, I think, is part mm-hmm. of this. And I think another part is records keeping. Mm-hmm. When a decision happens to you, if you apply for a service from government and get told yes or no, mm-hmm. at that exact point in time, imagine if there was a citizen's ledger. Mm-hmm. If you could actually see, I applied for this, I was told no based on these laws, based on this data, on this date. And if you had access to that forever, then if 10 years later someone says, we paid you some money 10 years ago mm-hmm. and you need to prove why, you can say, well, it's in the ledger. It's mm-hmm. right here. So that kind of traceability and visibility, mm-hmm. I think, is a very important part of trust as well.
Yeah, so for our Taiwanese audience, the second part of what Pia just said would be the equivalent of our national healthcare insurance, My Health Bank, in which that all the prescriptions, all the decisions made about your health, and including the traditional medicine as well, is recorded there, and dentistry visits as well. And you can, of course, appeal each and every one of it. But what Pia have outlined on the first part, the digital legislation, is something I think really groundbreaking. In Taiwan, I don't think many citizens have access to the source code of the kind of regulation that affects them every day. The one exception I can think of is that when you're trying to get a new insurance or to open a new bank account and so on, the banks do have this regulation for anti-money laundering, for knowing your customers and so on, which started as regulation, but they've pulled together and translate that as code. And one of the presidential hackathon teams said it's the part that they really want to open source because different interpretations by different banks lead to chaos, right? So they really want those anti-money laundering and know your customer regulations to be software code. And therefore, if you get rejected and so on, you actually can go back to that piece of code. But that's also because banks are heavily regulated industry players. Mm-hmm. And the healthcare, of course, in Taiwan is a national universal healthcare. So aside from those very highly regulated businesses and industries and enterprise, which are already doing some of that. Are you saying that even in less heavily regulated business sectors, there's still a benefit to be had, and how would that happen?
Well, first of all, it's very interesting that you brought up the AML-KYC regulation, mm-hmm. Or AML-CTF, as they call mm-hmm. it in Australia, because mm-hmm. That's where I started with the journey, mm-hmm. Because we identified that every financial regulated entity was implementing the rules differently, and the cost and burden on them to do so was quite high. And that actually creates a lockout for small entities, for small companies, for startups, because the onus of interpretation and the risk of implementation and translating it correctly is entirely on the organization itself. I had just one bank tell us that if we made just the prescriptive rules from AML-CTF available as code for them to consume, mm-hmm. it would save them $16 million a year, just one bank,
exactly.
Which was quite
extraordinary.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I think that I don't think it's a matter of boiling the ocean, because a lot of people, when they hear about this concept, the very first thing they think is, oh, but there's so much legislation and regulation, where would you even start? The simple answer to that, and I do direct people to have a look at the French government, who have who are ahead of all of us in this, a small team there in the innovation team over there, started this journey. They built a tool to create pure legislation as code for the purpose of service integration, so that you, as a citizen, can say, you know what, I want to anonymously know and plan my own life around what I'm eligible for. Mm-hmm. Help me know what I'm eligible for so that I can feel empowered and confident to go and apply, or indeed to just plan my life. And so they built, I think, the first, you know, true legislation as code system, and that didn't just enable good service delivery, which is where they started, it enabled modelling. So now my understanding is that anyone who wants to produce policy change mm-hmm. needs to show the demographic and budget modelling of mm-hmm. that change across the whole sector, which is very exciting. So I think the opportunities for government is key. For heavy regulated, to your point, there's definitely opportunities. But I don't think this area is fully fleshed out. Mm-hmm. It's not a reason to not start, because there's areas absolutely to get started. But how far to take it mm-hmm. is something still to be figured out. The key point that I think your audience will find interesting is, rather than just continuing to codify legislation or regulation after the fact, mm-hmm. the key insight that we had in New Zealand was, when you get drafters and policy people and software developers and designers in the room together from the start, you can actually create from the start mm-hmm. human and machine readable legislation from birth. You can create what they call isomorphic drafting. So you're mm-hmm. drafting in two languages. Now, of course, in Taiwan, you'd be very mm-hmm. used to drafting in multiple languages, yes. you know, and making
20.
Sure.
So just clarity. Make machine code the 22nd language.
Exactly. For any country which is more than monolingual, this is a fairly comfortable concept of mm-hmm. having just another language. Mm-hmm. But the outcome of that, of course, is that you get not just better drafted, human-readable mm-hmm. Legislation, but you mm-hmm. end up with a reference implementation of legislation as code that can be immediately used as soon as it passes the parliament, which is a very wonderful outcome.
Excellent. So in addition to the sign language interpreters, we will now have machine language interpreters in the drafting stage. I think that's a very, very powerful innovation. So after another short break, we'll be back to talk about the long-term vision, like 50 years long-term vision, and also the open government partnership. And we're back. Pia. I think nowadays people are thinking about 2050 a lot, at least in Taiwan, because we committed ourselves to net zero emissions by 2050. But as I mentioned in the introduction, in 2020, you wrote 20 articles, reflect on your 20 years of experience and called the series the PR Review, very nice pun, and in which you said, no, 30 years is not long enough, right? 50 years at least or more. Why is this very long-term vision important for the future and also for now?
So what I have, I'm a sysadmin at heart. As a sysadmin, I look for patterns. I look for how the system as a whole works. And once I see a pattern, I can't unsee it. One of the patterns I started to see, is that most futures-based planning is either focused on an existing problem or trend, and what does the projection of that look like and how are we going to react to that trend, or 5 or 10 or 15 years planning where the goal is to people are naturally trying to mitigate their biggest problem or address their immediate opportunity. It's very short term and very normative. Mm-hmm. You end up with a lot of future strategies that are actually just perpetuating the status quo. And there are absolutely times where the status quo is fine, but you wouldn't know otherwise unless you try to explore something else. So I was actually inspired, to be honest, so I can't take any credit for this this approach, but I was directly inspired by engagement with Indigenous cultures, mm. particularly in New Zealand, Aotearoa, with Māori culture and ways, but also in Australia, the absolute variety of Aboriginal ways of working, ways of being, ways of thinking. And one of the key things about at least those sets of Indigenous cultures with whom I'm somewhat familiar is they're very good at thinking into the long-term future mm-hmm. and the long-term past simultaneous with the present, yep. so that the present immediate action can be informed by the past but towards a future, a values-based future. So I started experimenting with, in collaboration with a few people, but experimenting with what would happen if we actually get people in a room and say, what would 50 years good look like? What would 70 or 100 years good look like? And this is not about predicting the future. This is about taking the shackles off the imagination, taking the constraints out of the conversation so people can say, you know what? A really great day if, you know, for health might look like this, for education might look like this, for participatory democracy might look like this, for if I lost my job might look like this. Mm-hmm. What it draws out is different people's values. It draws out their hopes and their fears about the very future. And when you start to draw lots of different examples about what does the future good look like for you and what does the future bad look like for you, it gives you a whole bunch of characteristics of future good that you can build into your immediate design and implementation today. But it also gives you the characteristics of future bad that you need to mitigate against today. So it actually drives a very values-driven approach. It creates the genuine opportunity to put a light up on the hill that is avoiding people just walking around in the darkness, but actually converging together towards a better future. So, and it, just to badly paraphrase Alan Kay, it's not about, you know, no one can predict the future, but we can invent it.
Exactly. And to reinvent it, we need to reimagine it. And the 50 years or 100 years, it's the long now, right? That kindles the reimagination. I think Tim O'Reilly in 2010 said that government 2.0, it's not a new kind of government, but rather a government stripped down to its core, reimagined as if for the first time, which is a quite powerful quote. So in your understanding, in your reimagination 50 years or more down the line, how would government look like?
Well, firstly, just a very quick story. I actually did a event in New Zealand where I invited a number of different thought leaders from very different backgrounds to give their 50-year futures. And they were very diverse and very interesting. And some were scary and some were exciting. And but all of them provided a huge amount of opportunity for discussion and such. But I remember meeting with a very esteemed public servant to invite him to present. And I asked him to what his 50-year future would be, and he said, oh, well, I'm going to talk about this framework. I said, well, no, but what does your 50-year future look like? And we got into a bit of an argument, and finally he said, but Pia, I'm a public servant. You know, it's not my job to tell people what their good life for them looks like. Good future for me is a future where everyone can prosper and thrive according to their own values. I said, say that. Mm-hmm. And he just hadn't thought about it. So, for me, I think on one hand, it's about having a situation where everyone actually has the dignity of in their life, the dignity of choice, dignity when they have things go wrong in their life to be supported in the right way, the dignity of their cultural and linguistic and political autonomy and these kinds of things. But to be a little bit nerdy for a second, the future for me is also about having an augmented life. I don't see the future as just, using a tool here or there. I see it as having, embedded and augmented humans where we have an experience with each other that is not through interfacing through machines, but by being part of a connected network of augmented humans.
The brain the size of a planet. Yeah,
pretty much. I see like major opportunities there. And also in things just like those helpers. I'd love to be able to say, we did a video of a virtual reality version of a helper, an Alexa-style thing that says, hey, Pia, the government's just, opened up a new piece of legislation that changes this policy in this way. Would you like me to put in your usual preferences? Would you like me to do this? Would you like me to model the impact it will have for your community and your family? I love the idea of individuals being able to use technology for them to better participate in shaping the policies and shaping the services that they need and that affect them every day. And that being done at scale rather than only the people that have the time available to it. The final thing I say about Into the Future is we are still in an industrial paradigm. There's still an assumption of working, you know, 5 or 6 days a week for X number of hours, mm-hmm. and that your unit of time is your measurement of value. Mm-hmm. I'd love in future to see your value measured by the impact, the positive impact that you've mm-hmm. had on the world, and for us to actually have more time freed up, frankly, to invest in our families, in our communities, in our culture, in our democracy, rather than everyone being 100% at work and then 100% at home, exhausted and just trying to deal with home and not having any capacity to contribute to their own or their societal evolution.
That's excellent. A switch from proof of work into proof of, say, participation or community or society, I think is a really, really powerful vision. But in that vision, how would the different jurisdictions of very different values of what counts as impact coexist in such a domain? Because we've seen many jurisdictions take different measures in getting the appealability. They can concentrate all the data, or they can say, you know, the Bitcoin people just resolve this with code or whatever, right? So there's different ways to go toward what's on paper, the same vision, people according to their dignity, people who can free up their time through some sort of automation and assisting. But that takes away some of the normal agency that we now feel that we have nowadays. And you've worked in Australia, in Canada, in New Zealand. I would say that these jurisdictions share similar norms with Taiwan, but not exactly the same, right? So I want to ask, can different countries or jurisdictions use the same kind of vision and strategy and then tailor-made the kind of local values and norms in a way that still empowers those different jurisdictions to work together? Because that's the next logical step after we all get our legislation as code.
For sure. I think there's three things that are helpful for that question. Mm-hmm. The first one is I think we need to say upfront that every culture, even the three that I've worked in, as similar as they might look from the outside, are entirely different cultures. Mm-hmm. So I think the first thing to say is that every culture will have its own norms and its own values. And the best way that a public sector can ensure that its policies and services and administration is fit for purpose for that society is to create participatory governance. Because if you take a participatory approach where you invite the citizens into the process of developing whatever you do, you have a better chance that your public sector will be reflective of the uniqueness and the values of that society, of that culture, those cultures, that community. So that's the first thing, which is not replicable. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The second thing, though, is that there are definitely some principles and ways of doing architecture and systems that is replicable. Mm-hmm. So modular architecture is it sounds like a very boring technical thing, but for those listening, all it means is that rather than having big systems that can do one thing well, you try to break systems up into their replicable parts. And if you can actually have a system of systems where each small part can be interchanged with something else, you now have in government, mashable government. You can create new services easily. You can deploy new products easily. You can deploy new grants or benefits or changes to the system easily. So there is certainly, I think, architectural principles, structural principles, software that is replicable and able to then reflect the diversity of that particular country. And I think the third thing is that when it comes to trustworthy, of course, people will have different types of needs when it comes to not just trust with their specific government, but also with different departments in the government. Mm-hmm. You know, what you need to trust your intelligence agency is going to be different, what you need to trust from your social services agency and emergency services and et cetera. But there is some basics, I think, that we can all follow, which really go to the basis of administrative law or whatever the equivalent is in pretty much every jurisdiction, which is if government departments can operate in a appealable way, in a trust, high veracity way, in a traceable, auditable, accountable, monitorable way, then that can that will help public trust regardless of the social and cultural differences between different nations.
Okay, so although the individual decisions may be very different according to the culture, the pattern in which we make those decisions, that is to say, to make it accountable and veracity first, right, and putting those into design principles, that's the part that different jurisdictions and different agencies and different levels of government can freely share. That's a really powerful insight. My last question, and this is a question that I'm facing as we're setting up the Ministry of Digital Affairs, so it's a work question. When we're doing regulation or legislation as code, the norm for legislation or regulation is free of copyright. Just like the appealing process, the ideas of individual judges written in their comments and the legislators recording and so on, none of that are copyrightable. On the other hand, the implementations of these legislation now as code is copyrightable. And many system vendors would rather that they only do what we call this inner source sharing or source code sharing. That is, they're perfectly happy to say the government owns the copyright, but with this clause that says, but only people in the same department get to access this source code. I don't mind people remixing it, but I do mind that people of different cultures, different jurisdictions, and so on, see how this source code is implemented. Now, in many corners around the world, and our shared friends and their organizations are not advocating what they call the public money, public code, the PMPC campaign, which says that no, in the software world, in the open source software, we do not put a what they call a use restriction, right? So it must be free for all to use. And this all, including cultures of very different worldviews, living in entirely different jurisdictions in which there's no good appealing process in the courts. Nevertheless, we should provide our source code for those people to use in those, frankly speaking, non-democratic jurisdictions. It's a very interesting campaign, and we're now seriously considering the two arguments that I just made. Have you considered similar things?
I absolutely have. So let's draw a parallel, I think, to DNS. DNS is a, for your listeners who are not technical, DNS is domain name, is the protocol that enables domain name lookup. So when you go to, you know, a URL, any URL, it's how you map to the IP address, the actual address of the computers behind it. DNS, of course, is critical for any system on the internet. And the very first and prevalent DNS implementation was, and there were many, many DNS implementations around when the internet first started to take legs. But the prevalent one was licensed under a, as a reference implementation, it was licensed under MIT license, which explicitly said that you can reuse it however you want. You didn't even need to, you know, contribute the code back. You didn't even need to provide attribution. You could even change the license if you want. That made it easy for anyone to implement it, whether you're private sector, public sector, nonprofit sector, an individual, anyone could implement it anywhere. And it was because of that ease of implementation that it became commonly used, and that created a lot of consistency and interoperability across the system. I think that government, and again, it depends on your jurisdiction, but every government within their constitutional legislative framework is responsible for some very specific things. Now, generally speaking, every government is responsible for legislation and regulation, but there are other things that depends on the constitution, right? I think that the things that government are uniquely responsible for, it is important that government provides a reusable, accessible reference implementation that anyone can use. If people go and choose to interpret legislation into their own business systems in their own way, they absolutely can. They can go and build a proprietary version if they wish. They can go and build whatever they want, as they do today. But if you don't have a reference implementation, particularly of something so important to justice as legislation and regulation, then you are creating actually a barrier to access to justice. And so this is where government needs to stand right back and say, what is the public good? What is sustainable and has longevity for our role in society? Not just choose the path of expediency and implementation, because what's expedient to implement today is a huge opportunity cost at helping create a fairer tomorrow.
Thank you for these very empowering remarks. Are there anything else you would like to share with our audience? Anything that I have not asked?
I would love to know your 50-year or 100-year idea for the future, what a day in the life would look like for Audrey Tung in an ideal and perfect future.
Like 50 years in the future, where I'll be 90 years old, right? I think one of the things that I do agree with you is that the kind of dignity that people feel according to their own culture, it's not just about personalization, because when we talk about personalization nowadays, it has this very atomistic, individualistic view. So in my ideal world, the communities themselves are also living beings. And this is actually a fundamental insight way back from the ages of Lao Tzu and Confucius, which is the social relations are also living beings in their own rights. And the individuals are embodiments of it, just as we can see that the groups are the superset of people who belong to that member, like people who participate in a certain Linux conference. But so are each individual, the intersection, in an intersectionality kind of way, between our social affiliations. So in that sense, the Linux user group is as alive as you and me. And I think that personhood. In New Zealand, of course, you've been innovating with natural personhood with the Maori people, which speaks to some of that idea, like the entire river and so on. But I do think that in all sort of different community configuration, not necessarily about natural resources or the commons and so on, any social groups that has this kind of living, breathing norm should be treated as first-class citizens. So not just people as users and machine as users, but also communities as first-class citizens.
I really love that. And I think it also speaks to self-sovereign systems. If governments truly want to empower citizens and communities to be and live their best, creating capacity for individuals to participate in governance. Imagine if we had a gap year that was just a civic gap year. Mm-hmm. Imagine if we provided the opportunity for anyone to spend a day a week paid to work on whatever policy area they're passionate about. There's a capacity issue there, because most people with capacity are already quite privileged. Most people who are under capacity are less privileged, and so we need to make that more equitable. But also, if government can see itself as empowering, to your point, living communities to have their self-sovereign systems and to interface with and recognize as just as important and living a system as anything that government produces, then suddenly you can actually be a platform upon which not just individuals can thrive, but whole communities can thrive. I think that's a wonderful and powerful vision. Thank you.
Thank you. Internet of beings and internet of communities. Thank you, Pia, for joining today. And to our audience, please check more information and video on TaiwanPlus.com. We have a YouTube channel too. If you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. See you next time. Live long and prosper.